Well, I would like to highlight three episodes in my life that I feel have really shaped my research and professional careers. The first one started in 1974 when I returned to Sudan after obtaining my doctorate degree in mathematics from Oxford University and joined the University of Khartoum as a young lecturer, and later I became professor and dean of the Faculty of Mathematics. I did my research in theoretical plasma physics, which was a very exciting field of research at that time because of its application to controlled thermonuclear fusion and the big promise of unlimited supply of energy, as you all know. My research resulted in formulating and solving a complex system of nonlinear partial differential equations and the derivation of a simple diffusion equation that has been used to study transport processes in fusion experiments. I think it would be boring to describe to you in detail the partial differential equations on this occasion. Upon my return from Oxford, however, I soon felt a discouraging sense of isolation without access to current journals and with no scientists working in my field to speak to, my research output started to increasingly wither. At the same time, my father, who was a successful businessman, wanted me to help him to expand his business, and he asked me to travel to Italy to purchase machinery for his new soap factory. I was pleased to do so, especially that it would also give me an opportunity to do a detour and visit the International Center for Theoretical Physics in Trieste. There, I met Abdus Salam, the founding director of the center, for the first time. I explained to him the research challenges that I face in Sudan and my intention to move away from research and work with my father. He appeared deeply concerned. And in order to help me remain in science and not be lost to the business world, he offered me the associate membership of the ICTP, which I gladly accepted. Being an associate of the ICTP enabled me to travel to Trieste several times over the course of the next few years, breaking my isolation at home and actively resuming my research work in theoretical plasma physics. I also started to develop a keen interest in the physics of windblown sand and dust in dry lands, a phenomenon that is rampant in most of African countries, including my own country. Together with my colleagues, we developed physical and mathematical models that improved our understanding of the movement and impact of windblown soil particles and the resulting formations of complex surface features in desert lands like sand dunes that move across the desert for miles and miles. The model that we developed also found useful applications in snow drift studies. That was the first episode. My second episode started in 1982 when Salam informed me about the meeting he had with a group of eight eminent scientists from developing countries present at the 1981 plenary session of the Pontifical Academy of Sciences here in the Vatican. It was at that time and at that meeting that the idea to establish the Third World Academy of Sciences was first discussed and unanimously endorsed by the participants. And Salam was asked to turn the idea into reality. He then surprised me by asking if I would be interested in helping him launch the academy. Obviously, I could not say no to a man whose intervention really saved my research career. The following year, 1983, I was invited to visit the ICTP to help organize the foundation meeting of TWAS. The meeting was a great success, but there was no money available to run programs. The truth is that at that time, many funding organizations and advocates of international science did not really feel the necessity of having an organization like TWAS. But it was 1985, shortly after spending a year at Lawrence Livermore Lab on a Fulbright scholarship, that Salam informed me that the Italian Minister of Foreign Affairs, Giulio Andreotti, decided to provide $1.5 million to support the launching of the academy and its initial activities. So I was requested to come back to Trieste for 3 months to help in this process. But little did I realize that this 3 months stay would turn into a commitment spanning nearly 25 years, during which I served as TWAS founding executive director. During that period, thanks to the continuous support of the Italian government, TWAS has witnessed substantial growth in its membership program, international recognition, resulting in the Academy becoming a leading voice of excellence in science in the developing world. In 1988, TWAS organized a major conference on women for science, and that really resulted in the formation of the largest organization for women in science in the world with 7,000 members. And in the year 2000, at their General Assembly in Tokyo, members of the Inter-Academy Panel, this is the global network of academies of science in the world, decided to transfer the secretariat of IAP from London to Trieste to be hosted by TWAS. Shortly afterwards, Yves Carey and Eduardo Kriga were elected IAP co-chairs. In 2003, the Italian government approved the law to fund both TWAS and IAP on an annual basis. And in the year 2000, the same year, 2003, the same year, the Inter-Academy Medical Panel also decided to transfer its secretariat from Washington to Trieste. So these four organizations, TWAS, the women organization, IAP and IAMP, together with the ICTP, this is a huge International Center for Theoretical Physics, the mother center, and the International Center for Theoretical, International Center for Genetic Engineering and Biotechnology, this system of international centers really make Trieste a unique place for international collaboration in science, technology, and innovation, and in global science policy debates. I was really privileged to be able to contribute to the development and growth of this unique system of international organizations, the so-called Sistema Trieste. The third episode was in 1985 at the inauguration of TWAS in Trieste, when the African scientists present under the leadership of Tomo Diambo, who was a member of this academy, he passed away several years ago, met and decided to establish the African Academy of Sciences. I worked closely with Tom to develop AAS during his formative years and later succeeded him as president of the academy from the year 2001 to 2011. AAS is modeled on TWAS, but it has a very specific and focused mandate, and that is to look at developing capacities and promoting excellence in science and education in Africa. It is based in Nairobi. As executive director of TWAS and president of AAS at the same time, I was privileged, I was in a privileged position to promote synergies between the activities of the two organizations, especially those that relate to building capacities, supporting young scientists, and science-based development in Africa. At the beginning of my AAS presidency in the year 2001, I was very concerned about the status of national merit-based academies in the continent. At that time, there were only 7 merit-based academies among the 53 African nations, and all, with the exception of the Academy of Sciences of South Africa, were pretty inactive. The 7 academies met in 2001 in Nairobi and decided to form a network, NASAC, the Network of African Science Academies, under the management of the African Academy of Sciences. And I was elected president of this network, NASAC. With the support of IAP, TWAS, and the US National Academy of Sciences, we launched a major program to strengthen the 7 academies in Africa and to establish new ones. So as a result of that, 19 new academies were established in Africa in the following years. This network of science academies in Africa now has 26 members, and it is one of the 4 powerful IAP-affiliated regional networks of academies. Well, finally, I would just like to say the following. Although both the African Academy of Sciences and the Network of Academies of Sciences in Africa have developed and implemented very important programs to support excellence in scientific research and education in Africa, compelling challenges stand in the way of progress towards achieving the sustainable development goals in Africa. Addressing these challenges needs the full engagement of the scientific communities in Africa and the academies of science as well to assist in developing strategies and to implement those strategies for the SDGs. This will require organizing regional and global forums that bring together leadership from the scientific, development, finance, and diplomatic communities to discuss and implement common action plans. The Pontifical Academy of Sciences, in my view, will be a very effective partner in this effort. And I am greatly honored and privileged to be a member of this academy. Thank you very much.
Congratulations for your new membership. And I think our academy will count very much on your experience worldwide, and in particular the continent of Africa, which we never forget, but often we have not enough knowledge.
Thank you very much. I'll do my best.
Okay.